As the global population continues to grow, with no real sign of slowing down, the question of resources becomes a greater concern. Will we have enough food and energy for everyone on Earth, both now and in the future? It turns out, the way to maximize our resources might actually involve killing two birds with one stone, or saving two birds with one tree. I don't know. The point is that the answer to both food and energy strain might come in the form of agrivoltaic solar systems. The idea is to create holistic ecosystems that use agriculture and solar power to maximize the potential of both. How do these systems work? And can they really be the solution to sustaining a growing global population? Stick around as we explore these questions and more today on Tuba Da Vinci. Special thanks to Ren for sponsoring this video. Find out how you can have some fun and combat climate change with Ren. If you've ever driven past a solar farm, one thing you may have noticed is that they require quite a bit of space. Of course, they need all that space to generate enough electricity to make them viable. And in general, that's a good thing. One drawback of their size, some say, is that it renders the ground beneath them completely useless. This poses a problem for farmers who may want to use their land for both solar and more traditional farming. The main issue is that the spaces between the rows of panels are too small for modern farming equipment to pass through. There's also the issue of the panels themselves blocking the sun from reaching plants. We'll dive more into that in a little bit. One final issue with today's solar panels, ironically, has to do with heat. Traditional ground-mounted photovoltaic panels usually have gravel underneath them. Studies have actually shown that this can create what's known as a heat island effect. Basically, the gravel absorbs heat from the sun and radiates it back, creating little hot pockets or islands of heat with temperatures above the surrounding area. The problem here is that, believe it or not, solar panels don't actually particularly like being hot. If solar panels get too hot, they actually lose some of their efficiency. Panels tend to do best when they actually stay somewhere between 59 degrees Fahrenheit and 95 degrees Fahrenheit. However, one solution might actually solve both of these issues simultaneously, and that's where agrivoltaics come in. The word itself, as you might have guessed, is a combination of agriculture and photovoltaics, and the concept is essentially to create novel ecosystems in which crops and solar panels work together to maximize the potential of both. Sounds great, but how would this work exactly? As we mentioned above, when soil or gravel absorbs heat, it gets trapped under the panels. So with agrivoltaic panels, or APVs for short, instead of soil, farmers would plant veggies under the panels. As plants take up carbon for photosynthesis by opening up their pores, or stomata, they also allow water to transpire through their leaves, creating a cooler microclimate, reducing the heat island effect and boosting the solar panel's efficiency. One challenge for agrivoltaics is engineering the optimal design that fulfills all the requirements for livestock or crop farming, while also keeping the cost of solar panels low enough to remain profitable. This can be done in a number of ways. With livestock farming, solar plant design doesn't change all that much from a solar-only project. Animals are actually beneficial to solar farms because they can actually reduce the cost of maintaining vegetation growth without introducing any risk to the panels themselves. Some farms have even integrated solar parks into the design of the living areas for smaller livestock like chicken, geese, sheep, and even beekeeping. In 2016, the Enel Group in Greece began using sheep to basically mow the lawn around their solar panels, which led to both reduced costs of maintaining growth while also reduced fuel consumption to power larger machinery. In these instances, however, the land underneath the panel still isn't really usable, and things get even more complicated with larger livestock like pigs, goats, and cattle. So, what's the solution? Well, just like Tony Hawk, the answer is going vertical. Speaking of win-wins and solar efficiency, I have to talk about our sponsor this week, Ren. I started this channel because I was tired of hearing the doom and gloom about climate change. Because while it might be the challenge of our lifetimes, I believe it is one we can win. With Ren, you can calculate your carbon footprint, then start a monthly subscription to find amazing initiatives to offset it. You even get to see month by month how your contributions are making an impact towards the solution. They have some pretty amazing projects like this one that removes flammable dead wood from California's forests to stop wildfires. They then turn the wood into biochar, a stable form of carbon that persists for thousands of years. Instead of releasing the carbon by turning it to ash, they can then sell this biochar to farmers as fertilizer. future is going to be awesome, but it'll take clever thinking and it won't come free. With Ren, they constantly monitor all the projects to make sure they're hitting the carbon offset targets they strive for. Plus, their impact is a true force multiplier, because planting new trees or protecting old growth forests is the carbon offset gift that keeps on giving. So don't let anyone tell you it's hopeless or too late. Take action today and offset your carbon footprint using Ren. The first 100 people to sign up using my link will have an extra 10 trees planted in their name. Huge thanks to Ren and all of you for supporting the show. Vertically mounted bifacial panels collect solar energy from both sides, hence bifacial. This allows for more energy per square meter than traditional single-phase panels. Not only that, but these panels have interesting features that make them particularly beneficial for farming. The way these panels are mounted creates more space between and below the panels, which allows more space for farming equipment, while also keeping them out of harm's way from larger animals. In fact, by design, these panels need to maintain a certain level of clearance to protect the stilts from machinery, preserving more of the arable land surface. These panels can also create a slight wind shielding effect, which can protect land and crops in areas with higher wind speeds. Some panels can even be outfitted with actuators that allow them to tilt in different directions. This can also allow farmers to optimize solar efficiency as well as plant growth. Even with these modifications to the panels, not all crops benefit from APVs equally. In fact, research has shown that there are particular types of plants in particular regions that may fare quite well when paired with solar panels. As we know, plants need sunlight to produce energy. We've done a whole video on artificial photosynthesis, which you can definitely check out here. So, wouldn't the shading from solar panels hurt the plants? Well, not always. While sunlight is a crucial element in plant growth, it provides the photo in photosynthesis. Plants can't actually convert all the available sunlight into biomass. Once plants reach what's called the light saturation point, they can't absorb any more energy. Once plants reach that threshold, they expel that excess energy by evaporating water. Some plants have higher thresholds than others. Sun plants, also known as shade intolerant plants, require higher levels of sunlight. These would be the living surfer plants who love to spend all day having fun in the sun. On the other hand, some plants do better in partial shade. Both groups of plants still have a saturation point, but one group is much higher than the other. Still, both groups can benefit from at least partial shade to avoid essentially getting sunburned. What this means is that pairing solar panels with certain crops could actually create a cooperative ecosystem in which the plants and the panels are mutually beneficial for one another. So how does this pan out for the real world? Grown Leven, a subsidiary of the BayWa Group in Germany, has conducted a number of pilot projects to see how agrivoltaic panels might actually work in the real world. Working with local fruit farms, the group focused on crops like wheat, potatoes, celery, and various types of berries. Berries happen to be a notoriously fragile crop. For one experiment, the group turned about 3 hectares, that's about 7.5 acres, into 2 megawatt agrivoltaic farms while leaving 1 hectare as a traditional farm for their control group. Typically, for growing crops like raspberries, the farm would use a plastic cover to protect the vulnerable berries from overexposure to not only sunlight, but wind, rain, and other elements. Data from these experiments revealed that on hot days, temperatures beneath the panels were between 2 and 5 degrees cooler than traditional growing methods. This brought a number of benefits. One, it significantly reduced the heat stress on the plants, and 2, reduced the evaporation from the soil, which meant less watering demand. At night, the heat was better retained under the solar panels than under the plastic coverings. Eliminating these plastic sheets could be a major win for farmers who often end up having to replace them throughout the year as they get destroyed by hailstorms. In fact, during summer storms that occurred throughout the duration of the experiment, the crops under the panel sustained no damage whatsoever, while the harvest from the control field was completely destroyed. These results aren't isolated to one experiment. The U.S. Department of Energy conducted experiments with chili peppers and tomatoes. The peppers yielded 3 times more with agrivoltaics compared to the control. Water efficiency was 65% greater for the tomatoes and 157% greater for the jalapenos. Plus, the experimental panels were about 9 degrees Celsius cooler than the control, leading to efficient electricity production. So, judging by these experiments, pairing agrivoltaic panels with the right crops, especially in hotter, more arid regions, could yield positive results for both the panels and the plants. So are we gonna start seeing more of these agrivoltaic solar plants popping up on farms across the world? Well, that will depend on a number of mitigating factors. One major concern for farmers is how introducing agrivoltaic panels may impact some of the subsidies they receive from the government. Both the EU and the US offer grants for land used primarily for agriculture. One crucial question will be whether farmers will still be eligible for financial support if they introduce more of these types of solar systems. It's a question that may come down to percentage, how much land is used for agriculture versus how much is dedicated to solar. There are also issues relating to cost and permits required to build these solar structures on farms. Offsetting the construction and permit cost with better crop yields may be enough to turn heads. But like most things, it will likely come down to the market to decide the fate of this emerging technology. Agrivoltaic solar doesn't yield as much energy as traditional solar. Not only that, but the cost per kilowatt hour can be between 10 and 20% higher than traditional solar. Other factors include who will actually profit from the energy produced by the panels. In the Netherlands, for example, the farmers are neither the investors nor the owners of the solar installations. Therefore, participation comes down to the impact on crop production. Most farmers are only willing to participate in these types of endeavors if their crop yield doesn't fall below 80% of the normal numbers, according to the Fraunhofer Institute. And that's only if the farmers can make up that 20% reduction from their energy produced. Right now, there are plenty of better incentives in place to choose either crop production or solar production. So it may come down to government intervention on price guarantees. Without these factors, agrivoltaics may never stand a chance at even getting off the ground. Still, it's hard not to dream about using this type of eco-conscious engineering to design better cooperative systems to better integrate green energy into other currently underutilized places. It will be the companies that come up with the right business models that will truly bring this idea to light. Sure, it might not be for all crops, but the benefit of reduced sun stress and water evaporation and better solar efficiency is enough to really make a big impact, and enough of one to not be overlooked. But what do you think? Do agrivoltaic systems deserve a chance, or should we just invest in keeping things as they are now? Sound off in the comments below. The biggest impact that I think people aren't thinking about enough is lower evaporation from the soil, which means you don't need to water your crops quite as much. That could be the biggest factor, even more than producing energy. So that is a look at agrivoltaic solar systems. What do you guys think? I'm really curious if you think this will take off. This to me sounds like one of those perpetual projects or studies. It'll be interesting to see if they actually make it into large-scale production. All right, thank you so much for watching. A huge thank you to all of you. Pardon the noise, we're outside again while we're setting up our studio. But a huge thanks to all of you for watching. And if you want to be a rock star supporter of this show, consider becoming a patron on Patreon or a YouTube channel member. We love you guys. We call you the 2-Bit Tribe. Come join us on Discord. We can chat, figure out future video ideas. You guys can edit scripts or whatever else you want to do. And I'm Rick Retuba Da Vinci. Just take a look around. There's other videos we think you're going to like. And until next time, just remember the future is going to be awesome.